Before I ask our esteemed panel to join me on stage, I'd like to do a very quick introduction, if I could do, and also tell you a bit about me and where I'm from. I'm from Contagious, which is an intelligence resource that looks at the very best in non-traditional advertising, experiential marketing, design, branding, and emerging technologies. But I think, from our point of view, it feels weird to be standing here talking about digital as a term. Okay, simply because 99% of our connected lives nowadays are digital, so to be making that definition feels slightly strange. Okay, the kids, teenagers who are, in theory, digital natives, and you'll forgive me for using a cliche, but the consumers of tomorrow, they certainly don't think in these defined terms. So why should brands and advertisers, okay? So what does this mean for these brands and advertisers? Well, I think, in a way, it's both a blessing and it can be a curse. A curse in so much as people know exactly what content they want, they know where they can go to get it, and they want it now, now, now. Okay, it's a quick fix culture. With that in mind, they can and will tune out of advertising, which makes it really, really tricky. If you look at the brands, however, that are doing really well now, it's things like Facebook, Google, these are brands that are built on engagement and community, not on the traditional model of reach and frequency. And that is how it can be a blessing, because these brands and advertisers are now being forced to think outside of that traditional model of reach and frequency and look towards things like utility or entertainment or corporate social responsibility or even just building meaningful and lasting relationships with consumers. These are all the sort of things which we're going to be talking about today, hopefully, and exploring, you know, ways in which brands and advertisers can go beyond that established territory. Before we crack on, I'm going to introduce our very first speaker, who's Doug Jaeger. Doug has experience designing and managing brands across a wide variety of media. He attended Syracuse University as a multimedia artist with training in object-oriented programming, 3D modeling, photography and video production, and interaction design. In his early career, he established the digital creative departments at two of the world's most respected advertising agencies, JWT and TBWA. When he turned 28, he started the Happy Corp, a lab that allowed him and his experience to explore how design, technology, and the human experience would impact consumer relationships with brands. Recently, he was elected the president of the Art Directors Club, where he leads a diverse board in the growth of the 89-year-old creative salon. He's apparently always looking to do something new, and he tells me he does the majority of his traveling on two wheels. So please welcome Doug Jaeger.
Hello, everybody. How you doing? This is kind of a wide podium. I come here from New York, and I'm the president of the Art Directors Club. The Art Directors Club started in 1920 as an organization that was there to connect, provoke, and elevate creative minds. They started by helping artists work with the commercial world. And I see here there's a huge conference of the commercial aspects of the digital world, but not a lot about some of the creative things going on. So today we have a really amazing panel of things going on. And we thought we'd divide it into three areas. We want to take the work and show you really, really great examples of the work. We want to look at the people behind the work and some of the challenges they're having, and then also discuss very specifically pragmatic tools for you to look at your own solutions out there in the market. Following that, we want to hopefully have a really good debate about everything we discussed. So we're really excited to be a partner with DMEXCO. We think it's a really, really cool conference. And we hope we can bring more creative language to this debate. But before I talk anymore, I thought I'd introduce Jeff Benjamin. I'm going to read a little bio about Jeff. He's someone that I've run into many times in this business as a leader. I actually tried to hire him once, but now it's too late. He's too expensive. I'll tell you about Jeff. After foregoing a career at agencies including Modem Media and Goodby Silverstein & Partners, Jeff Benjamin joined Crispin Porter Bogusky at the end of 2003. He very quickly became the interactive executive creative director. At Crispin, Jeff has created some of the industry's most game-changing creative campaigns, such as Subservient Chicken for Burger King, Work for Microsoft, Domino's Pizza, Coke Zero, and Best Buy. Jeff has been recognized nationally and internationally by every major industry award show. There's an award Jeff has his name on it. He's really, really talented. And it's exciting to have him on this stage tonight, today, wherever we are. Time is really strange for me right now. He's been showcased in several publications, I would say almost every publication, including the Wall Street Journal, the New York Times, Contagious Magazine, Communication Arts, and Newsweek. Jeff also is occasionally featured on television on shows on CNBC. But during his free time, Jeff competes nationally in yogic flying high jump competitions. So I welcome to the stage Jeff Benjamin, who's going to take us through some really amazing cases.
Yes.
You can stand wherever you want.
Oh. Hey, guys, thank you. Thanks a lot for inviting me here. You know, I've been in the industry for about 12 years now, and I remember being a young creative and just getting into it all. And you know, you'd look around for inspiration, and I'd always look at the stuff from Germany. You know, the design was amazing, but the innovation was so far ahead of its time. And you know, as a young creative, like I would look at the books and I'd see what's going on in Germany and stuff, and wow, I'm big up there. and so I'm excited to come out over here and maybe share some things that could inspire you guys. So I thought today we could talk about, a few months ago, I was lucky enough to be the president of the cyber jury at Cannes. And you know, you go into that and you know that you're on a quest with the other jurors to sort of find work that's going to inspire the world. And you know that, right? And you're there for a reason. People think that you know something. But over that time, you learn so much. And I thought I knew a lot going into it, but I was so inspired, and I learned so many things about our industry, about what works, and I think about the future of interactive and interactive advertising. So I thought today maybe we could take a look at some of the things that I really loved from Cannes, and we can talk about, you know, some of the trends that started to show up when we saw this work. And then I thought we could also look at some of the work that we're doing at Crispin and how maybe that fits into some of these trends that we're going to be seeing in the future. So with that said, I wanted to talk, you know, like, and I didn't even realize this until, you know, months later when I was looking at the work that we had kind of picked up on and saw, you know, wow, that's a lot of cool work. You know, is there anything that all of it sort of has in common? And I started to see this theme of creatives sort of becoming inventors. And innovation has always been a part of our industry, right? We're always trying to one-up ourselves and the kinds of things that we do, whether it be in media or in websites or outside in the real world with digital. But it seemed like this year more than ever, you really saw these projects, and it seemed like people were like tinkering, experimenting, really inventing. And that got me really excited because it wasn't just about innovation. It was about big ideas behind that innovation and then taking big risks and tinkering and making different things. You know, this, when we looked at all of that work, you could really say at the end of the day, creative success at Cannes, it was defined by this ability of creatives to invent, clients to invent, brands to invent. And as we look at some of the stuff, I think you're going to see that. So the first one, we're going about to play a video, but not yet. I have to give them a special signal. Was a piece done by Samsung. You know, you're going to see this, and it looks like it was made like by a bunch of inventors somewhere. Not by creatives or advertisers, but a bunch of inventors somewhere. It doesn't look like it was made with a lot of budget, which I think is also something that comes from invention. And let's play that video now and take a look at it, and we can talk about it in a second. So video one.
Our mission was to demonstrate how tough the damage-resistant Samsung B2100 is. We did this for a live experiment on samsungshakedown.com. We put 70 mobiles on a glass table, placed high over a concrete floor and a water tank. Each phone had its own number, and the vibrators were switched on. Four cameras filmed the mobiles and streamed it live to the site. Now people could call any one of the mobiles and try to vibrate it over the table edge. If your call caused a mobile to fall down, you won that mobile. As the lines opened, the buzzing sound of 70 different mobile tunes filled the studio. and one by one the mobiles vibrated over the edge and smashed either onto the concrete or into the water tank. And of course you could call the phones after they fell to make sure they still worked. Not one of the mobiles was harmed during the test. The campaign was run in several rounds and created a huge amount of buzz online. Whereas Samsung B2100 used to be popular within certain industries, this campaign introduced it to a much wider audience, showed off the product's benefits, and entertained them along the way.
So, I mean, just like an incredible invention, right? Like, it looked like it was made out of somebody's garage or basement. And it got tons of press, tons of views, and was really powerful for the brand and showed off, you know, the product features, that this thing was basically indestructible. The next invention that I wanted us to take a look at was a mobile one. And I thought this year was a really big year for mobile. There was a lot of great mobile work. But this piece really stood out. And I think it kind of showed a powerful lesson about invention, that sometimes the best inventions, the best ideas, are the ones that are born from real problems, right? And so I don't know if you guys have ever been shopping and you're like at the furniture store and you're like, wow, that's a cool chair, but is it gonna look good in my place, right? And you don't really know until you actually buy that chair and take it back to your house, put it in front of the table or put it in the room, and then you finally see, you know, if it works or not. And if you're like me, you're too lazy to go return it, so it ends up in the garage or basement for a long time until you have a garage sale. But IKEA came up with a really amazing mobile app. And what this did was, basically, you'd find the chair from their catalog. It was their way of doing a catalog. And then you'd, with your phone, you just hold it up to the scene, and the camera, basically what would happen is that chair or table or whatever the piece of furniture was would get superimposed into the room. And we can check it out now. So let's play video 2.
IKEA, introduction and goal setting. IKEA has launched its new 2010 catalog. Since the catalog is one of the company's primary sales tools, publicizing its launching was one of our main goals. On the occasion of the launching, a mobile action with two aims was created. The action sought, on the one hand, to make users acquainted with the new furniture in a novel, interactive way, and on the other, to serve as a loudspeaker that would spread the news about IKEA's new catalog. The solution. To this aim, we developed the 2010 IKEA Interactive Catalog, a free application that can be downloaded at Apple stores from any iPhone or iPod Touch. The application has two sections: Place Your Furniture and Discover Your Style. In the first section, users are able to choose from more than 40 novelties in the catalog. They can then use their mobile cameras to actually place the selected piece of furniture anywhere in their homes, test how it looks, and take a snapshot. Users are also able to adjust the furniture size, making it bigger or smaller, and move it around to get the desired effect in the picture. In addition, users access all product information from the application itself. In the second section, users are able to discover the style that better suits their taste through different quizzes that present furniture pairs. Users' choices are used to define their own IKEA style. The results. The launching of IKEA's interactive catalog was widely communicated in the media, especially on technology and interior design blogs. It also enjoyed high downloading rates at Apple stores, where it is one of the most popular applications.
Video cables, one on the left
side,
one on the right
side. So, you know, just a really useful invention.
The one on the right side.
And I think the other cool thing here is that, you know, they, I guess, you know, when the agency or the brand, the problem that they had, you know, along with solving, you know, how does this chair look in my house, their assignment was to take the catalog and bring it to the mobile device, right? And I think a lot of places would just say, hey, let's just make our catalog a little smaller that we got on our website and people can flip through it. But they said, look, if we're going to do it in the mobile device, what can the mobile device do that the computer can't? Or that a paper catalog can't. And in this case, it was that ability to have the camera phone and be able to superimpose the product right in the space. They said that's what's genius about putting a catalog in the mobile space, and that's what we're going to do. So I thought that was really interesting. This next thing we're going to look at, I think, really points to the future of how, you know, maybe creatives are going to work, how agencies are going to work. Because, you know, with a lot of these inventions, right, you're looking at it and you're like, is it just an art director and a writer who are working on this? Because that's been the paradigm, you know, for a long time, you know, as we're making, you know, whether it be banners, websites, you know, whatever it is that we're doing. And when I saw this, it really pointed to the future of how we're probably going to be working. Because you see engineers, technologists working side by side with the creatives. And this next thing, I think the only reason it could exist, the only reason it could happen, is if you had a team of not just an art director and a writer, a creative director, but engineers, a tech person, creative technologists, whatever you want to call them, all in the same room together, at the same table, working together to make something great. You know, there's other things I could say about this, but, you know, at the end of the day, when I saw this, I mean, this thing was just really, really cool. And it's, you know, when we were judging, this thing, it was maybe the oldest piece in the show. It had been around for maybe a little over a year. But when we looked at everything, it still felt like the freshest thing there because it was so awesome. So if we can just play video 3.
Just want to let you know that after long talks with my kids, the rest of my family, close group of friends, I have decided to return to professional cycling in 2009.
I am here to fight this. I am here so that I don't have to deal with it. You don't have to deal with it. None of us have to deal with it. My children don't have to deal with it.
This must be a global health priority. We know that we cannot do this alone. I cannot guarantee an 8th Tour victory, but I can guarantee you that the Live Strong message will touch all aspects of our society, all continents of our society, and certainly touch on all the different diseases and facets of cancer that need the attention. It's not about me.
It's about my sister.
It's about my dogs.
Hang on. It's about my son.
It's about sharing my story.
So people can compare their stories to mine.
Getting back to the mound, it was a struggle.
I was on the highest mountain in the world, fighting for my life.
Yeah! If I can get through 6 rounds of chemo,
then 50 below,
100 mile an hour winds,
pitching a no-hitter,
seems easy.
It's about you.
We built Chalkbot together so that people from everywhere can spread messages of hope and cancer survival to the entire world at the Tour de France on the streets. It's a fully pneumatic robot. We're all friends working on the development of it, so it's literally friends working together, building a really cool thing that millions of people are going to be able to see and experience and interact with.
The way that people treat things changes a lot once it's physical. People will feel a lot more connected to that, to the message that they send. So it's not just a throwaway text, it's not just a yo, I'm sorry, right? It's, you know, now it's somewhere, right? Now it's something.
To print a message in sort of memoriam of a lost loved one or in honor of someone fighting cancer and see that appear on the road in a Tour de France that they could never participate in physically, that has the power to be very comforting, I would say.
As a software person, you're just constantly cranking out HTML, you're cranking out images, you know, you've got whatever. It's rare that you end up with something that's actually potentially really important to somebody. And so it's just like a really good feeling.
See the riders are going all over the yellow chalkbot there. Let me remind you, while the Nike chalkbot follows the road to the Tour de France, you can follow the Nike chalkbot at home on Twitter or at wearyellow.com.
So, you know, an amazing invention that only happens with art directors and riders working together with technologists. And I think that does point to a future of how we'll work together. And these are the types of ideas that'll happen when we do that. This next one, it's something that we worked on at Crispin. And I think it talks to a theme that we saw in a lot of the work. Certainly all the stuff that we've looked at so far. But throughout, you know, a lot, it was a trend that we saw over and over again, and I think we're starting to see it even now with some of the successful things that are coming out, things like that Old Spice campaign, the response campaign through Twitter and stuff. And it's this notion of what was yesterday that static page, right, that you just go to and you look at, it doesn't really change that much. Static experiences that brands create turning into real-time experiences, right? And if you're an inventor coming up with things that you kind of don't know what's going to happen. It's a big experiment. You don't know if you're going to be successful or not, and your idea, your brand idea, just sort of becomes an event, a moment that we all get to sort of experience together. And we use tools of the internet, things like YouTube, Twitter, Facebook, all of these things to amplify that event or that experience. So this next one is Shocking Barack, And I know personally that there wasn't a lot of budget. This company didn't have any money. Nobody knew about the brand. And in a really quick way, we had to make an impact with little to no money. And we didn't know what would happen. We didn't know if it'll be successful. You know, it was entirely possible that no one would have noticed this. But that was sort of the risk you take. And in the end, it did work out. So let's play this next video. Video four.
The big three American automakers came to Washington saying they needed a bailout.
This is a slap in the face to the taxpayers. To come to Washington on a corporate jet and ask for a handout is outrageous.
We wanted to retrace the journey taken by the big three automotive CEOs in 2008. Only we are going to get there on electric motorcycles at a cost of about $4 per guy.
Brammo is a small company with a big idea, the Inertia. The world's first highway-legal 100% electric production motorcycle. Our trip would be designed to accomplish three goals. Make Brammo famous without any advertising or media budget. Position Brammo as a leader in the fight for additional government funding of electric vehicles and empower everyday Americans to affect political change. The hub of the project was shockingbarack.com. It served as a makeshift social community, and it was a recruitment tool for outlets, couches, and political contacts. It was a new form of live advertising, one that enabled content to be created, produced, edited, and published in real time.
You guys need electricity.
Social media delivered the story to traditional media, and soon the national media was listening.
People have lost faith in America's ability to innovate, and we believe that we're riding two-wheeled evidence to the contrary.
By the time we reached D.C., the bikes had become a rolling petition from the people to the president. Every call we made, every door we knocked on, every hand we shook,
brought us one step closer to realizing the goal. And then it happened. Mounting social pressure caught the attention of the man who oversees the nation's energy policy.
Craig just came out of a meeting with Secretary Chu.
Obama asked for 1 million vehicles by 2015. And, you know, we're kind of signing up for 150,000 of those.
Hopefully this will further pave the way for one of these bikes to actually get to Obama, although the bigger mission is definitely being accomplished here. If we're honest, we haven't done what we came here to do, and that's give the president an electric motorcycle. Ryan is chaining this bike to a pole, and we're going to take the key to that lock, and we're also going to take the ignition key. These are going to Barack Obama.
It's not the fairy tale ending that we had hoped for, but it's a real ending, and I think that's maybe even better.
So, you know, a story told in real time that can only be told today, because we have things like Twitter, Facebook, you know, the internet, you know, pages that we can update in real time. And again, you know, when we started that thing, we had no idea what would happen. The bike could have not even lasted, you know, one day. And I think when we invent, those are the risks that we sort of take. But when it works out, it can be really great. There are two more things that I was going to show next, but I'm going to skip them. But again, both I'm going to tell you about them because both of them were examples of this sort of real-time advertising, right? You know, we saw a lot of this real-time stuff throughout Cannes. And maybe one of the best examples, you've probably seen it. If you haven't seen it, you can take a look at it at home, was the site We Choose the Moon. And that was an interesting thing because it was a real-time story, but it was a story told from 40 years ago in real time. In the same way people were glued to their radios when these guys were headed up in their rockets, you know, headed to the moon, the same way people were glued to their radios 40 years ago. When this thing came out, people were glued to their computers, except instead of listening to radio messages, they were watching the videos on YouTube, they were looking at the site, they were listening to the tweets from the astronauts. And the same way radio was a storytelling device 40 years ago, now Twitter and the internet had sort of become that real-time storytelling innovation for us. And then the other one that I'm not going to show you that you should also check out was 12th Force, which was in real time being able to use Best Buy's army of blue shirts, right? All these people who work at Best Buy, being able to allow them to sort of tweet back to customers when they had questions, answers to whatever technical problem they had or question they had, and they would do anything. If you wanted to know the difference between an LCD and a plasma, you know, one of the blue shirts would get on and tweet back to everybody, you know, the differences. There were even kooky ones. Somebody tweeted out, you know, what's the best battery for a vibrator, and of course the blue shirts responded that is a rechargeable battery. Again, a great tool for them, and that was something that we worked on. And you know, for them, the customer complaints after 12th Force went down by like 20%. And just twittering, not very expensive. And then the best example, maybe, of this whole real-time thing trend that we're seeing, it was CAN itself, because you know, while I was out there for a couple of weeks, you would see people tweeting, you know, what's going on? You know, how's this thing doing? And people just had this insatiable urge to kind of want to know what is going on out there. And then I think the people who were there, like your friends and stuff, they would want to tell you over Facebook or Twitter and stuff. And so we live in this new era now where these real-time experiences are just sort of, they're just a part of our lives. This last one I want to show you is an invention that we recently worked on at Crispin. And again, it was born from a problem. You know, you're in the theater. I don't know if you're allowed to have, are they allowed to have phones like in the theaters in Germany? I don't know. You have to turn them off in America. So this was kind of it was dealing with that tension. And it was also that we wanted to do sort of a brand thing with a movie partnership. And you're going to see this in a second, Despicable Me. And usually, you know, brands, You'll see this in the video. They'll take characters and things and just put them in commercials. But we wanted to come up with an invention, an innovation, that solved a problem for people, that made the movie experience better for people in a way they hadn't experienced before. That was the Best Buy technology that we wanted to bring to this movie. And so let's take a look at. We're going to skip a few videos. So you're going to click on number 7. Video 7. The last one.
The classic movie promotion. We've seen it 1,000 times.
I think I need a bigger box.
So when Best Buy got the chance to team up with the movie Despicable Me, we knew we had to do something different. Something that allowed Best Buy to not only promote the movie partnership, but to enhance the movie experience itself. Meet Best Buy's Movie Mode, the first ever cross-platform smartphone app to utilize embedded sonic cue detection technology, allowing the viewer to interact with the movie itself. So what does that mean? Well, when the cute little yellow guys spoke their gibberish, moviegoers could use their smartphones to translate every word right on their screen. How did people react to Movie Mode? So far, so good. Since its release, it's been downloaded over 320,000 times. That's over 1 million minions translated and counting. And with the upcoming DVD release, we expect millions more. This revolutionary translation application really has people talking, and talking, and talking. And Despicable Me is only the beginning. With Best Buy Movie Mode, what people expect from their movie-going experience will never be the same. Thanks for watching. We hope you enjoyed the show.
Fun invention. You've got these phones in your pocket that aren't getting used. You know, what if you could use them within the movie to make that experience better? And so that's a technology that Best Buy owns now. They're patenting it, and they're going to roll it out for other movies as well in the future. So those were just, you know, a few things that, I've seen in my time as sort of trends that are happening and things that sort of point to the future and the way we work and the kinds of things that we're going to do. One thing that we didn't look at a lot of media stuff, and I know a lot of you guys whether you represent publishers or you're more into the media side. One thing that I would say is we're in an invention economy now, right? People want to invent. Success in the digital space is about invention. So what I would say is, if you're a publisher, to make sure you make enough room for brands to really invent in your space. You know, I know you guys have, you know, the consumers who look at your sites and things like that. You don't want to piss them off and stuff, but give room to invent, because I think the future that we have, right, the work that's going to work and inspire in the future, it's going to need space, and you're going to need to break the rules a little bit to be successful. So thank you guys a lot.
So one of the challenges I think you're all thinking out there is, who are the people that make this stuff? As our clients want more and more digital work, finding digital talent is becoming really, really difficult. A lot of people that I know in the business that are leading these agencies, big major creative ad agencies, are leaving the agencies to start smaller, more nimble companies. And so one of the things that the Art Directors Club is really concerned about is connecting talent, provoking talent, and elevating talent. And so we thought for this conference, we'd put together some videos to show you guys the challenges that these creative people are having. So they're themed on connect, provoke, and elevate. And I thought we'd show you the videos once at a time, and then I'll talk a little bit about each one. And the last video I'm going to show is from a classic ad guy named George Lois, and some of his work has been put into the Museum of Modern Art. And just to give you context for the generational differences in doing what we do. So if you guys could play the first video, that would be great.
I think taking it back to the human point of view, they have to start flirting with me. What they want is they want a date with me. When you want a date, you have to be nice. If not, you have to eat on your own.
I think it's funny just looking over the course of the industry of technology and how it influences us, but then how we influence it as well.
The tricky part about it is you want to make sure as a brand that you're always having a conversation with the audience and not at the audience.
Competing against all sorts of eye candy, so you've got to make something either outrageous or funny or crazy.
Be entertaining, or be educational, or be a value to me. Do not be a hindrance, or don't necessarily try to sell me something.
You want to try for something that could be viral and get passed around. It's almost a filter when you come up with an idea. Is this something that people are going to want to repost and comment on and pass around? If not, then is it really worth doing?
The truest content is the stuff that usually bubbles to the top. That's not trying to be like another piece that you see. So it's creating that, which is, you know, a challenge in itself, and then doing it for a company that fosters it is exciting.
I make that argument to audience, to my clients a lot, where they come to us with things saying, hey, you know, we've got 188 million users. And I respond, hey, that's great. The internet is 1.5 billion. So let's keep going.
So all these people are part of a program that the Art Directors Club is doing called Show and Tell. And what it is specifically is getting great creative examples that are happening on the YouTube platform and the digital platform in a broader sense, and getting professionals to discuss how they're made, why they're good, and how to advance them. The next thing that we try to do with the club is bring provocative ideas and provocative content to the community. So the next video I'm going to show is about how creatives provoke each other and how we create provocative communication. If you could play a second video.
All of these technologies, YouTube and Twitter and whatever else they come up with next, it's not the technologies really, it's what's within them. It's very easy to get swayed by new technologies and the latest things, when really the oldest things are the most important: storytelling and persuasiveness and writing charming, witty things.
It's really at the beginning of everything. So imagine this, like 10, 15 years from now, what level we're going to be at.
If we're not scaring you a little with our ideas, then we're not doing our jobs.
We have clients that, you know, sometimes come to us and say, oh, we really want to have an iPhone app. Well, you know, why do you want to have an iPhone app? Or if you want to have, we want to have a brand channel on YouTube. Well, that's great. Brand channels are great on YouTube, but why do you want to have one? And not until you can really understand the answer to the why, I think, do you make a decision as to which, you know, which strategy to follow.
You can't create and replicate. You need to recreate each time. You need to make a new thing so that your brand makes sense in context of who your brand is. And if your brand isn't perceived in that way, you need to change the way your brand is perceived.
Behave as yourself in that environment. In the same way that if you go to the Yankees game, you're probably a little bit different than if you're going to church or synagogue at the weekend, and the way you dress and the way you speak is going to be slightly different. Doesn't mean you're not the same person, but you present a different facet of yourself.
The great thing about the web is when you have a great idea, it gets spread immediately, and you have instant gratification, instant recognition that an idea is working.
It's kind of like lighting fires. You know, you light 10 fires, and if, you know, your seventh fire starts suddenly raging, then you put more wood on it. So there's like, actually, you've got one hit, but you've got nine failures. I think very few people are kind of content to say, actually, nine failures is okay.
So that was the provoke theme. And the last thing is elevation, and that's what we're doing today, is looking at really great creative examples, sharing them so that we can be inspired to create the new and new things. So why don't we play the Elevate video.
One of the interesting mistakes or paranoias of the industry is all these good things, we must use them all for our clients. It's a case of showing some restraint as well as understanding everything that's going on.
When you view a video, the engagement from the viewer with the brand is much, much stronger than just seeing an ad.
Video has become an option for a lot of brands that in the past may not have even used it. So brands that may have used print in the past to communicate a message now can use video to do so.
For the brands, it is very important to focus on your roots and on your core business. If not, I think you fade away.
There's the Wayne Gretzky story, right? And why are you good? Why are you always, you know, where the puck is? It's like, I'm not looking to go where the puck is. I'm looking to go where the puck is going to be. And the same adage holds true in the online space.
This branded content, branded entertainment is so much bigger. It's what the whole industry, I think, is going to be moving to.
It's become a really interesting kind of active medium in which you can be a lot more experimental, a less rule-bound than with a lot of traditional media.
I don't even think in mediums anymore. You just sit there and you say, you know, how am I going to get the story out?
So you can see the kind of conversations that creative people in the community are having. It's a challenge of what media do I use? How do I get that medium to connect with an audience? Jeff earlier discussed the idea that, you know, we started with an art director and a copywriter, and now there's a new career type, which is the creative technologist. And a lot of schools today are actually specifically training advertising students in technology. How do I specifically connect Twitter, Facebook, YouTube APIs to my client's website to create a meaningful creative expression? How can I tell a story in that way? These are very different conversations than what we would have maybe even 5 years ago before platforms like YouTube existed. But I thought it would be relevant to play a video of a kind of an advertising legend to kind of contextualize what the meaning of communication and marketing is, and the notion that what we're really here to do is simplify messages and make really meaningful connections with people. And a lot of the technology we're creating is not fully formed, and there's a lot of experimentation, a lot of failure. But in the end, what we desire is the ability to actually make connections and creative connections. And it is the creative community's responsibility to make them elegant and beautiful and lasting. And so I thought I'd finish off my portion by showing this video of George Lois, and he talks about the specific notion of design and how important it is in everything we do and how important a consideration. So if you could play the last video, that'd be great.
I'm George Lois. I was president of the Art Directors Club in 1972, the year we started the legendary Art Directors Hall of Fame. The largest category in the Art Directors Club awards show each year is entitled Design. To tell you the truth, I'm not even sure what design means. Personally, I have never regarded myself as a designer. I am a graphic communicator because I create big ideas, not designs. Surely, great graphic design is not merely the aesthetic arrangement of lines and shapes. Great graphic design is the transformation of a big idea into an unforgettable image. In this astounding new world of technology, all the tools in the world are meaningless without an essential idea. An artist or advertising person, a doctor, a lawyer, an electrician, a factory worker, or president, without an idea is unarmed. But be warned, the capability of a computer to produce bells and whistles can never inspire the conception of a big idea. When an original idea springs out of a communicator's head and intuitions, the mystical blending or even juxtaposition of concept, copy, and art, whether in print advertising, TV commercials, posters, book design, magazine covers, editorial design, pack design, logotypes, or websites, can lead to magic, where one in one can indeed be three. When that idea is dramatized by a unique image, in synergy with words that memorably communicate in a nanosecond, there is always an immediate intellectual and visceral human response. All dedicated graphic communicators must spend their spare moments drinking in the art created by generations of artists who have been the antenna of human sensibility. Artists who understood the art of their past, but who broke with it according to the needs of their time. I see our role as graphic communicators as precisely that of the revolutionary artist. But our kind of art has nothing to do with putting images on canvas. Our concern should be, must be, with creating images that catch people's eyes, penetrate their minds, warm their hearts, and cause them to act. And additionally, a truly great graphic communicator reflects and captures the zeitgeist of the time. Indeed, it's mystically ahead of the culture. To be confident we can produce successful results as communicators, we must believe that creativity can solve almost any problem, because the creative act, the defeat of habit by originality, overcomes everything. In a profession that should have no rules, I have three commandments for all to heed. One, reject group grope. Two, reject analysis paralysis. And three, to truly produce masterful work, reject con, create icon.
Boring stuff. Thanks very much, Doug, for that. What I'd like to do now is introduce the third of our panelists, who's hopefully going to give us a slightly more kind of pragmatic, production-based angle on things. It's Mark Pitlick. Mark is the founder and executive producer of the London and New York-based interactive production company Stink Digital. From its launch in January 2009, Mark and his team at the Stink offshoot have been responsible for some of Europe's most recognized digital work. Since winning a Film Line Grand Prix and Silver Cyberline for their work on Philips' Carousel campaign last year, the company has worked on numerous notable projects, including the launch of an interactive fashion catalogue for Diesel, a personalizable interactive film as part of Nike's 2010 World Cup campaign, as well as a live streaming digital pop-up store for Cadbury's. One of their latest big campaigns, a 12-minute interactive film for Lexus, was named FWA's Site of the Month for May 2010. I also happen to know from first-hand experience that Mark gives a mean 50 cents in the club at karaoke as well. So that's going to be particularly useful in case we hit a lull in today's proceedings. Please welcome on stage Mark Pitlick.
Stand just there.
Hi.
Okay. Hi.
Thanks, Will. Cheers. So, hi, everyone. How are we doing? We're about halfway through. I'm coming to you from a slightly different perspective than the other gentlemen who've been on the stage so far today. They're obviously coming to you from a more creative, focused, agency-focused, centric place, and I agree with a lot of the things that they say. My perspective is a little bit different. As Will said, Stink Digital is a production company. We're an interactive production company, which means we deal with agencies and clients, and we really deal about the sort of pragmatic, practical aspects of getting something done for them. It's not just getting anything done, it's about making something great. And so our job, in a way, is really about finding a way to work with them and their infrastructure to make something awesome and to foster some creativity. Now, I'll tell you a little bit about how we started. It'll be quick, I promise. Stink is a television commercials production company. It's been around for 10 or 11 years. They've got a lot of really high-caliber directors, and they've been making commercials for that long. So that's something that they're very, very good at, is filmmaking and the filmmaking process. We started Stink Digital based on Stink about 2.5 years ago. So, you know, we're the interactive little brother. We're the interactive half of what they do. And what it means is that we work with a total mix of agencies. We work with a lot of agencies that Stink has worked with before, which is very traditional, above the line, big network agencies. Then, of course, because we're a digital company, we work with a lot of digital agencies as well. And the productions that we work on are very different, too. Sometimes it's film, sometimes it's a mobile phone app, sometimes it's an interactive film. So it ranges. And the reason I'm telling you this, and the reason I'm telling you about the kind of range of the people that we've worked with, is because I feel like, as a digital production company, we're in a very unique place. Because, you know, we're not agency of record for anybody. We don't work with the same clients over and over. We bunny hop from one agency and one client to another and work with lots of different people. And what it actually gives us is a sort of very unique insight into the market at large. And, You know, we see work that ranges the gamut. You know, we get open briefs sometimes, and we get briefs that are very locked down. We work with people who are very organized, and sometimes people who are very disorganized. And it's you kind of get a window into the efficiencies and the inefficiencies of each company when you work with them. And so I think that kind of places interactive production companies specifically in a sort of unique place to try and talk about creativity and maybe try and put our finger on where sometimes it can fall down for some companies. So what I'm going to do over the next 10 minutes or so is kind of underline five very key points that I think are important to remember. And I'm going to intersperse that with a few case studies so that it's not just me talking. Some of this stuff is going to be blatantly obvious. It might strike a lot of you as blatantly obvious, and maybe not others. But the thing to remember is that, like, it's in this deck for a reason. It's in it because it's something as a production company we always run up against. So just bear that in mind if you look at some of these and shake your head and go, yeah, that's a no-brainer. It doesn't always work that way. So, you know, because we come from a production company, I'm going to focus on the pragmatic aspects of things, you know, the very practical. You want to make something awesome. Everybody wants to make something amazing over here. Everybody has that desire. But sometimes that desire is upended by infrastructure, by politics, by lack of communication. So I'm going to try and, like, get to some of those problems. And I'm also going to talk a little bit about things that I personally think are interesting, because we see all kinds of different work at our company. And sometimes you notice trends, you know? For 6 months, it's like everybody wants to do something that talks to Twitter. Everybody wants to do something augmented reality. Everybody wants to do a little bit of this. And it's totally fine. That's how the industry works. And there's always going to be best in class of those types of jobs. But I thought it'd be interesting if I talk a little bit about what I think is coming up next as well. So, five things to remember. First thing, and this is probably the most obvious thing, is to interrogate your infrastructure. So most bad habits start at home. And, you know, there is a bridge between wanting to make something awesome and not being set up to support making something awesome. This, like, manifests itself in really, really basic and really, really simple ways. You'd be surprised, but sometimes we get engaged by people who want to do something and they don't know if it's possible, which is great. That's a good thing. If you don't know if you can do it, that's a sign that you're onto something. But they want it done now, or they want it done for no money, or they want it done before they pay for it, kind of thing. And that's not how creativity works. If you want to give somebody the room to make something awesome, you have to give them that room. So scoping and research and development are an important part of the business, and I think it's something that, you know, as marketers, we should try and be mindful of. I think it's very tempting to think of R&D as kind of like this ugly, nasty thing that doesn't really yield anything because there's no communication at the end of it. But the fact of the matter is, this is an investment on future communication, and sometimes, or oftentimes, for the better. The other thing is playtime. You know, I loved everything that's been said so far today, especially all the chat about invention. And I think the links between creativity and invention are absolutely true. But invention is not a job. You know, people aren't inventors as a profession, necessarily. They're inventors because it's in their nature, it's in their blood. And part of inventing is playing. It's trying out new things, playing with new ideas. We were having a little chat about this earlier today, but I feel like sometimes the infrastructure of advertising doesn't necessarily allow for so much play. You know, everybody knows about the Google 80-20 rule because it's unique. You know, 80% is work, 20% is develop something personal. And that's interesting because it kind of, there's something true about it. And there's no reason that couldn't be the case in other companies. And I think it would yield sort of financial rewards as well. But in order to do that, you have to be willing to let go a bit. So for us sometimes, and we get caught up in it too, we're like any other company, but like the billable hour is sort of the thing that you work towards. You know, can I bill for this hour? Am I working towards a job? Is there like some finance that I can attach to this? The problem is, like, there's no billable hours attached to play, necessarily. So as a company owner, as somebody who runs a department, you have to be willing to let go of that a little bit. You have to be willing to take that risk and take a step back. The next thing I'm going to talk about, is point number two, consider your dependencies. So all this means is that sometimes companies say that they're set up to produce something. Companies are sort of intricate machines, and the nuances of how those machines work sometimes can produce something else. I think we've all kind of had experiences of that before, where the machine that we've built isn't creating the thing that we hope that the machine would create. The reason for that is because there are dependencies there that you're not thinking about. So I'm really happy to hear the guys talking about creative technologists. I think it's a very important thing, and it's an important step in the industry. But generally speaking, I mean, we're still kind of stuck in this model of you have creative people on this side, you have technical people on this side, and those two things, those two divides need to be bridged more. Too many non-technical creatives is a recipe for frustration and ruin, especially in digital. I can't tell you how many briefs I've seen where somebody has an interesting idea, but it's completely impossible. I'm not talking about scary. I'm talking about completely impossible. And you think, like, you could have saved time, you know, if you were with technical people. By the same token, too many technical people and no creative people will give you the website that we already knew that we could make or the app that we already knew we could make. And that's boring, too. So you need to make sure that, like, your dependencies are such that you have the curious people with the technical people, and they're talking to each other. I mean, a creative technologist, that's the ideal thing. That's the person that you want in that mix. But even if not, you have to make sure that the groups of people that you're talking together are kind of, you want there to be a nice friction there between the two, where they're sparking off of each other, and each is rooted in a different discipline. Lastly, and this is a huge, huge thing, again, some of you are probably nodding going, this is super obvious, but you'd be shocked. You'd be shocked at what we see sometimes. Accessibility and usability are absolutely like paramount to good digital creativity. Digital creativity does not exist in a vacuum. I've seen so many great digital ideas that are scuppered by bad UI, by bad planning, by not really knowing as the user where to go next or how this is supposed to work or what the output is. That's absolutely important, and you have to recognize that a good idea is intermeshed with all that stuff. It's dependent on all that other stuff going well as well. I had do you guys know there's a kind of famous Swedish viral called Be a Hero? It's been passed around quite a lot over the last couple of years. It's you upload a photo of yourself, and then suddenly you see that photo. You're being celebrated in this Swedish town. That has 50 million hits, 50, over the last 2 years. And I was actually having a conversation with Marcus at the agency Colony about it a couple days ago, and he said it was absolutely key for them when they were coming up with this idea to limit the amount of clicks, the amount of actions that the user had to do before they got this incredible output at the end, which is really, really important. He said there are four actions that you do. That's it. Like four button clicks total. And, you know, we're guilty of this, too. We've done projects where, like, the intro or what you're asking of the user is so long and so drawn out. By the time they get to the end, it's either not worth it or you don't keep them there for the whole time. So this is something to remember. Now I'm going to show you a project. This is something that we did for Cadbury's, and this case study. Do we have volume here?
A world first, real time.
So I'm going to talk you through this
shop.
A little bit because
it was created.
I don't know that the case study does a great job of explaining it necessarily, but bear with me. So this is something that we did for Cadbury Nibbles, and the idea was Cadbury had this designer scarf that they wanted to give away. They had 1,500. Exclusive limited edition copies of this scarf. So what we did for them was we set up a pop-up shop in a real-world location in downtown London, central London. And then we built a flash widget that we seeded to 20 different fashion partner blogs. And the flash widget contained live video of the outside of the real pop-up shop. Excuse me. So this was actually a two-day event. And in the time leading up to those 2 days, each flash widget on every fashion blog would say closed. But for those 2 days, we would randomly open individual blogs, storefronts, so that people could enter in. This was all run off Facebook, by the way, so there was the caramel bunny who was giving clues to people on where the store might be open now. So 19 of them would stay closed, but one of them would open. And when it opened, users could actually go in and enter into a queue. While they're in the queue, they enter in their personal information, so their name, their home address, some other relevant information about themselves, and they see their place in line counting down. What happens is, by the time they get to the front of the queue,
just one click to join the queue. Once in the queue, it was a tense wait to get to the front before the boutique closed and popped up somewhere else. And the best bit? It worked! A genuine pop-up retail experience, completely live, and in real time.
Sharon, hi, and welcome to the Cadbury's Caramel Nibbles Boutique. My name's Natalie. First of all, thank you. We've had a long wait. However, I'm very happy to tell you that you're actually one of the last people who's going to receive the exclusive limited edition Giles Deacon scarf. So well done, and thank you for your patience. Now, I'm just going to pop down your address. You're based in London.
So you see what's happening here. Somebody's entered in their personal information. Once they get to the front of the queue, they have a real interaction with somebody in the actual pop-up.
There you go. All ready for post.
That person has their address. They write their address and their name onto an envelope. Send them the scarf. So they have this little two-minute interaction that's very personal and very real. And that kind of leads to my next point, which is more appointment viewing. I think this is actually kind of the next big trend on the web, and I think there's something really compelling about it. We're kind of in a place right now where we have, you know, it goes without saying, information overload. There's always going to be a microsite for us to look at. There's always going to be a new app for us to play with. Even when we download something that's really interesting, we might only spend 5 minutes with it because we're on to the next thing. So what live events and giveaways and things that play with the real time do on the web is they make appointment viewing kind of interesting again, and they centralize things in a way that things haven't been centralized for a while. This is a thing that is happening now. It's really compelling. You know, Twitter's making that more compelling. Uniqlo has done wonderful work in this field. You know, trying to get discounts, doing giveaways, doing things that are happening online with live streams, all designed to sort of regather the user around the browser again and kind of reinitiate this idea of appointment viewing. Traditional microsite, we do them all the time, but it's easy to take for granted because it's always going to be there. And if it's always going to be there and you're taking it for granted, you might never look at it. But you know, something that's happening live, something that's happening now, something where there's a potential reward for the user or some kind of communication, it's intrinsically more interesting. Now I'm going to show you another piece of work that Stink has done for Dulux, and then just talk a little bit about our involvement in this. So that's a TV ad that my company recently shot for Dulux. And obviously it works beautifully as a TV ad, but there's a whole sort of integrated aspect of this, and we did all the production on that. The basic idea behind this is that they wanted to sort of reposition painting and putting color on things as a way of sort of like, as to promote a healthy lifestyle in a way. Like color and vibrancy is happiness. And they wanted to take that message across the world. So we actually went to India, Brazil, England, that wasn't so hard, and France, and recruited people, more importantly, in all of those communities to come out and re-energize their community. Then ran a whole social campaign on that online. There was a site that we did called letscolorproject.com. There was a blog that we did where there was a girl, a wonderful writer called Rebecca, who was updating it literally 5 to 10 times a day with just photos of color and sort of meditations on color. It was actually really beautiful. Then we did a bunch of short films about the making of this and kind of met all these people in the different territories and got to know them and their stories. And my point is that before we did this, because we were commissioned to do all of it, and we were terrified. We were absolutely terrified. Because it's one thing to say we can do an event like this in London. It's another thing to say we can do an event like this in Paris. But in India or in South America, like, we can do productions there, absolutely. But when it comes to trying to engage people socially, there's a bit of fear attached to that. There's a bit of fear attached to, like, whether this whole thing is going to congeal and come together. Which leads me to my next point. Fear is a good thing. Listen for fear. We have a saying in the office that if you kind of have this feeling when you get a brief that you're not quite sure that you know how you're going to do it, that means you should probably do it. Magic happens when we transcend the boundaries of our infrastructure. All that means is it's very, very tempting to sort of stay in your lane. You know, it would have been very tempting just to do this as a television commercial, or very tempting just to do this as a piece of interactive. But to have all those things talking to each other, of course, it's the Holy Grail. And it's the scariest thing, you know? Time can be a crutch. We had no time to do it, and that actually worked in our favor. Because there was only time to get a little bit scared, not a lot scared. If we would have gotten a lot scared, we would have probably bricked ourselves. So yeah, fear is a good indicator that you're onto something. How are we going to do this is a good thing. Remember that. If you're not scared about how you're going to pull it off, chances are it's not as interesting as you think it is. Lastly, I'm going to show you a piece that we did for Diesel. This is something that we shot in a pub in London over the course of 3 days. There's this Godard film called Bend Apart, and there's this famous sequence in it where three characters get up and do this kind of iconic dance in the middle of a cafe. I'm not going to do it for you. But we recruited about 100 people through the Diesel website to all come to London to shoot this music video, and we taught these people this dance. And then we shot this film, which basically shows people in this pub doing this dance. I'm just going to let it run through for a second.
100 lovers with the aim of making fun. There's just one reason. He sells his powers to the crowd.
So what happens is, over the course of this 3.5 minutes, these are jump cuts between three of the three people. Those jump cuts are going to amplify to the point where at the end of the video, they're basically happening every single frame. So you see this really lovely kind of flickering effect.
It's getting warm.
So that's kind of nice in and of itself, and it's a nice, interesting piece of content. But where it sort of got interesting, actually, I'll show you the flicker. It's just kind of like that. You can see it kind of building up over the course of the piece. Some of them really bad dancers too. Maybe a couple of them. There they go. So you get this really lovely effect. And this piece, like, as just a regular standalone bio, it's nice, it's sweet, it's entertaining, and, you know, the fact that we recruited people to do it is, it kind of has some cachet and some appeal, and, you know, it's important that anytime you do video content, it works in its own right. But what's especially nice about this is, obviously because this is happening in the context of a website, whenever I roll over onto any frame, the whole thing freezes. And it actually turns out that these people are all wearing clothing from Diesel's Spring and Summer 2010 fashion show. Right? So I can roll off of this and it will continue playing, or I can roll back onto it and get information about the clothes that they're wearing. Also, because we recruited these people online, we were very careful to find people who are creative, fashion designers, musicians. So when I roll over anyone's head, it'll give me their real name, a little fact about them, and then links to their Twitter page, their Facebook page, their MySpace page, whatever. So what this actually does, and then the last thing, is that this kind of floppy-haired guy that you see in the beginning, this is a musician called Josep. He's Italian, but he's based in London, and he's signed to Anomaly's label. Anomaly's the agency we did this for. So they actually own this song, and this song doubles as his music video. So in addition to being, you know, some marketing for Diesel, it's a music video for him. I think it had 1.1 million hits on YouTube just alone for him. So what we ended up doing here, and the thing that I'm really proud of, is that we managed to combine sort of a really nice viral with something that's kind of a social lookbook, because it's got, you know, links to different people's personal accounts and information, with a music video, with a fashion catalog for Diesel. When you went to diesel.com/springsummer2010, rather than having like a traditional sort of, here's all the clothes we have, you saw this. And that kind of takes me to my last point, which is listen to culture. And what culture is saying right now is not to be afraid of recombinance. You know, recombinance is the combination of lots of different things to make a new thing. This is not my ideal, which is kind of ironic. You know, this is Ferris's idea. Ferris goes on about this all the time. But recombinance is, you know, it's kind of the key to everything now. Every idea has already kind of been had. All you can do now is create new interesting combinations of things. This is totally separate from what I've just been talking about, but this is another thing that I sort of think about a lot. Advertisers versus startups. If you think about the people that sort of are the fuel in our industry, it's creative people, in the digital industry anyway, it's creative people, designers, developers. They're kind of the heart. And those people, if you're a designer, a developer, a creative person, you're probably going to live in one of two worlds. Advertising on this side, or startups on this side. And the interesting thing about those two things to me is that, like, advertisers, the people over here who are making campaign sites, who are making brands come alive online, they're kind of running a sprint. You know, everything's changing. They've got new communications every 2 or 3 months. They're churning stuff out. They're making it. And then it lives for a short period of time before they're on to the next thing. People who are over here doing startups, they're running marathons. And it makes me absolutely crazy that those two pools of people who have so much in common don't talk to each other more. Because I think we have a lot to learn from each other. That brings up another point, which is the death of the internet. There's this big Wired magazine article that went around a couple months ago proclaiming the death of the internet. All they meant by that was that the internet as a destination is sort of dying. People are going to the internet less for blogs and news and... Hold on, let me rephrase that. That's not true. The internet is less now about a place where people go for blogs and news and information. It's less a destination than it is a pipeline for data. And we use that pipeline for data in a lot of different ways. We can use, you know, Skype is an internet application. Hulu is an internet application. Our mobile phone apps are all internet applications, but we don't intrinsically think of them as being on the internet. So this idea, the death of the internet, is about the internet changing from a destination, a place you go to in your browser, to being a pipeline for data that manifests itself in different ways. Now, advertising has, you know, often talked about where it goes next, what happens after the microsite. And, you know, the big insight there is that brand utility is the place where brands should be. You should be offering a service. You should be offering something that integrates into the habits of people's lives and gives them something back. And that kind of ties back to this idea of the death of the internet. Everything is moving towards more sort of application than utility, and that all makes sense. But again, it brings me back to the advertisers versus startups thing. It makes more sense to me now than ever that we should be talking to each other, because that's kind of what these people over here in the business are doing. So anyway, that's just kind of my little ramble. 5 sort of insights. Thank you very much, guys.
Thanks very much, Mark. Okay, we're running slightly short on time, but we've still got a nice kind of whack where we can ask some questions to our panelists now. Again, I would reemphasize the fact that if you've got any questions you'd like to pose them, I'm going to ask them some questions first, probably for about 20 minutes, and then we're going to allocate about 10 minutes at the end where hopefully we'll have some questions put up on screen, your questions, which we can then put to the panelists. That's moderator@dmexico.de. Okay, so the first thing, guys, I'd like to talk to you about, I think a lot of the examples that you've all shown, particularly Jeff with Chalkbot, Mark with the Dulux stuff, is that while it's really smartly digitally integrated across all these different platforms, so Chalkbot used had GPS and had Twitter and its Messenger and email, and it was pinging on and offline, The most important thing about those campaigns is that at the center of it was still something very, very human, okay? It was a message. The Chalkbot slogan was, it's about you. Mm. In Dulux, it was something that really resonates. It was the fact that, you know, we can all identify with bringing color into people's lives. And what's your guys' take on this idea that, you know, no matter how digital things become, the really good work is the stuff that has a human truth at the center of it? And do you think this is going to become increasingly important as we kind of get, you know, information across all these different screens and, you know, are in risk of almost a data overload, really?
Yeah, I mean, I think that, I think you can point to almost every successful piece of advertising, especially digital advertising. It's got an idea behind it, and it's got a very simple, primal truth to it all, right? And you saw that in both those pieces. I think the other thing, too, is that there's a lot of innovation in both of these things, right? Amazing innovation, right, and invention. But when you take a step back and look at that, that innovation, that technology, is really invisible to the idea. And that's what makes it great. Like, the greatest, you know, there's a great quote, I don't even know who said it now, but I just take credit for it. It's that technology will reach its peak when you don't even realize it's there. And those were both examples of that, where the innovation of the technology was so great, you didn't see it, and all that you were left with was this beautiful idea.
So it's almost the avatar effect, as in that it's all this tech that puts you in this amazing
Pandora.
World, but once you're there,
about Pandora.
It's all about Pandora. Yeah, sure. A lot of people have called this post-digital. It's the idea that, you know, you kind of go beyond digital. But another kind of aspect of post-digital is this idea that everything in the real world is going to be connected. I think there was a stat, something like 5 billion physical products currently are connected, and that's things like your laptop and your phone and all this sort of thing. But now we're starting to see ordinary kind of like consumer products are being connected through apps like Sticky Bits and all this sort of thing. It's been called the Internet of Things. How do you guys think this is going to affect the sort of experience we have, and that we're no longer going to be shackled to our laptops, to our desks, to our computers, and that we can just be out in the real world and yet still be connected and having these kind of experiences?
I think there's a really interesting notion that there's opportunities for better communication to occur. Products like Foursquare and Facebook Places are making it possible for advertisers to connect at the moment when someone's in a specific place. I'm sure there'll be moments at your refrigerator that are the right time and right place for communication. So it's less shouting at these boxes and more likely that the story is being told in the appropriate context. And I think that's what's really exciting. Like we were talking earlier about how everything is based on a great story. And I think there's opportunities for these stories to be told in new places, as long as those things don't feel too weird.
Yeah. What are the implications of this, though, for brands and advertisers? I mean, it sounds like a really nice idea, but how do they get a handle on this, especially the brands and the big agencies who are used to more traditional stuff? I mean, this is pretty scary, right? How do you get involved?
I mean, for me, like, you only come up with all these ideas if you participate. And if you're a brand manager for a client, if you're a creative, if you're an account person, I don't care who you are, if you want to be a part of this, you have to participate. So that means buying things online, checking into places on Places or Foursquare, doing Netflix, tweeting. Even if you don't like to tweet, you got to tweet. Because unless you do these different things, you're going to never be able to figure out how to connect it all for your brand and understand what's good about it and what's bad about it that you might fix as a brand, right? For me, the big lesson is just to participate. You know, be part of it all. Because if you're not, you'll never come up with any great idea for any of these things.
The other thing is you can tell from a mile away when a brand has gone into that space but doesn't really understand it. Like, it's so patently obvious when a brand tries to involve themselves in Twitter or whatever it is and doesn't really know what they're playing with. And I think, you know, it's a disaster.
It's that kind of dude, we should do philosophy. Like, dude, we should do Twitter. We should do Facebook for the sake of doing it.
Yeah. I think that's exactly right. You have to live with it. You have to kind of integrate it into your life and figure out. Because the thing is, all of these technologies have, like, very specific nuances. It's very difficult, actually, to sort of explain in a simple way why Twitter is interesting. You know, and maybe somebody more eloquent than I could do it in like 50 words or less, but I find it really hard to communicate the sort of nuance of why it's great and why it's interesting and what it has. And I think the only way to do that is to use it.
Yeah, I mean, that's one of the really most important things, I think, is actually the time for play. You talked about that earlier. Just the idea of engaging in all these new technologies and playing with them so you understand the nuances and you actually can figure out how to use it for your brand's benefit. You know, without using Twitter, you don't really even know what it is. You don't know what a hashtag is. You don't know how often and likely people reply. You don't know what is annoying within the space and what is not even active.
Yeah.
You know, people think that by setting up a Twitter account, they now have Twitter, but you actually, without participating in the conversation, you really don't exist.
Mm. Do you find, I mean, Mark and Jeff particularly, do you find ever, though, that it's tricky to convince clients, say a big FMCG client, you know, who might not necessarily, you know, have the same mindset as Nike, to say, look, we need time to play, we need time to experiment and to fail. And, you know, is that a tricky sell at any point?
It's completely difficult for us. I mean, because normally we get brought into a project when either the project has already been signed off and there's a sort of definitive timeline on it, or when they're sort of scoping it out, but they don't feel like they want to release money on it yet. So it's like they're asking us to do some R&D for them for free. And so it's tough. It's tough. And it's a conversation that we keep trying to have. But it's a very, very difficult thing. It's like turning an ocean liner around. I would suspect that you guys probably have a much easier time of that at Crispin because you have that infrastructure in the house.
Well, I think part of the culture of Crispin is to have that time to play, right? You know, we don't have basketball courts and ping pong tables and pool tables around the agency. You know, part of it is coming up with these ideas ought to be fun. And you're expected to experiment and come up with things and just play, right? So that's one thing. I think the other thing, though, is that what you're saying, I think, was more the case previously. And I think we're at a point now where even big brands are progressive enough to know that experimenting, playing, taking chances, being in all these spaces and participating, both for the agency and then also personally as a brand manager or a media person, you have to do that to be successful. For some of our clients, like big ones, we'll even have a separate innovation budget where, you know, over the course of a year, broken up into quarters, there is X amount of funding just to innovate. Mm-hmm. And beyond a specific brand problem or a brief.
So it's back to that idea Mark was talking about, the 80 and 20, and the 80% is work and the 20% is play. Other people call it, I think, the 5% club or mass and niche, the idea that you can still concentrate on the stuff that you know works, you know, i.e. traditional, but you can spend 5% playing with stuff in niche spaces, and if it works, then that's the stuff that really, really kind of blows up, right?
Yeah, yeah. And then even, and I think that's when you're doing stuff for clients, but I also think as an agency, right, or as whatever you are, you have to give yourself time to do these things as well, aside from what you're doing for a brand, because it's that time when you're tinkering and things on your own that you discover stuff, and then you can bring that back to brands.
Sure.
Work on.
A lot of the great campaigns that we've looked at today, when we've talked an awful lot about things like Twitter and Facebook, these are sort of infrastructures and systems and services which are already there. Okay, these aren't lavish branded destinations and kind of mechanics that the brands are built from scratch. From our point of view, seeing the work we get submitted at Contagious, we've seen a lot of really, really great campaigns built outside of paid-for media and using these kind of systems. Is that something which you guys have found with kind of clients coming to you and saying, we want to do this? And if so, is it still a balance, as in kind of actually making sure you can do something there first rather than kind of retrofitting, you know, actually working out the idea and then seeing if it was going to work on Twitter or Facebook, as opposed to just kind of saying, right, we're going to do it?
I'm not sure if I'm understanding the question. Are you asking, do brands come to us and say, hey, make me a Facebook?
Yeah. Or perhaps more accurately, can I get me a million fans on Facebook? Which I think is something that a lot of them are saying.
Yeah. I think they're two different questions, right? And there have been different instances for us. And you guys might have other experiences.
Yeah.
But like a recent experience, we did a project for Vail, which is it's a ski mountain in Colorado. And what we did was we made it's a mobile app that lets you check in on the mountain in different places to let your friends know where you are. So it's basically Gowalla or Foursquare. And then it also, much like Nike Plus, lets you track, you know, the elevation, the different runs you've done, the time you did it in. And you can earn badges and things like that, patches. In a sense, it's like, you know, that's their own IP, right? It's sort of a mix of a Nike Plus Foursquare, but for the mountain. And then they're going to debut that this year. And so that's their own proprietary technology. Yeah. And they came to us to help them build that. Now, other clients might come to us and say, hey, look, we want to make a fan page and we need this many likes, right? That's the latest thing. It's not fans, it's likes.
Yeah.
What can you do, right? And we're doing a thing for Domino's now where that's sort of the brief, and we're coming up with ideas to kind of generate likes. And you go, you immediately go in and say, well, what do people in general on Facebook like, right? Like, not just for brands, but like, what are they liking in general with their friends and things? And you participate and you figure that out. And then you say, well, if people are liking that when they're dealing with their friends, how can a brand replicate those types of moments?
So it's about working out what people go to those platforms to do and what they do when
exactly,
they're kind of tapping
exactly.
into the mindset.
Yeah.
And then building a campaign around
yeah.
that instead of saying.
It's like, I think of it as like method advertising, right?
Yeah.
But that for us, that's sort of the system that's worked for us.
Yeah. Do you think though, in a way, that a lot of these campaigns, great campaigns built outside of paid for media, have created this sort of the sort of idea that you can literally generate millions upon millions, pounds or dollars worth of earned media for a very small spend because it's all built outside of paid for media? Is that kind of something which brands and
I mean, we've looked at some very successful examples today, but I mean, this is a small minority.
Yeah.
If you take a look at like some of the stuff that gets done routinely by brands, I mean, it's a ghost town.
Yeah.
Sometimes in a lot of these places. And so we've seen some very successful things. And make no mistake, a lot of these things did have earned media that helped form a catalyst to sort of kick things off. Yeah. But not earned paid.
I actually agree that is a bit of a myth. And we have done campaigns before where people have said to us, well, we don't have to spend any money on media because it's the internet. And if it's good, it will take off. It will just kind of take care of itself.
If it goes viral.
If you build it, it'll come. It just doesn't happen anymore.
Yeah. No, it needs
you,
it.
You
it
need really to accelerate. Yeah, you have to accelerate your viral media with paid media. And there's a lot of ways that YouTube and Facebook and all these other platforms allow. I mean, you guys are talking to them today. I'm sure they're having lectures on it. But there's always a way to accelerate the viral component.
I mean, I can pay Alyssa Milano to tweet something.
Right.
Like they're these Twitter celebrity services now.
Yeah.
Where you want something tweeted by someone fancy, they'll do it.
Yeah. There was an interesting study, actually, that just been published by Harvard only a few days ago, and they said, this is a quote, in effect, the videos that got watched the most on the internet are those that bought their popularity through traditional offline advertising, especially on TV, that kind of combination approach of paid for and earned media. Do you think that's a fair assumption?
Absolutely.
So campaigns like Old Spice and that kind of stuff.
Old Spice started as a television campaign that basically became a Twitter, YouTube campaign, but it was a character that was already loved and liked. I mean, they took a celebrity and put them on Twitter. It's gonna work. I mean, there's no doubt about it.
But it was content, rather than being content that was thought, well, this is gonna work as a TV ad, it was content that thought, this is gonna share, this is gonna spread, and it also works as a TV ad, right? It's kind of, instead of it being a TV ad that if we're lucky will go viral, it's content designed to be shared. Right.
I mean, some campaigns are so brilliant or so special that they transcend the rules that we're trying to lay out here, and I think Old Spice probably falls into that category. But what they did that was clever was they recognized that they had this thing that they could spin off and that they wouldn't necessarily need to put a ton of media behind it because it had that sort of momentum on its own.
Sure. Okay. Before we invite some questions from the audience, there's one more particular trend which I'd like to kind of quiz you guys about. It's something that we haven't actually touched on much today. We have a little bit. We're talking about Foursquare and Gowalla, but it's something that I think, again, this do we should do philosophy that a lot of brands and advertisers are now starting to think about. And in a moment, I'll ask the guys to play the video, which is called Epic Win. And I'm going to talk about gaming mechanics. So basically, it's this idea, for those of you not familiar with gaming mechanics, it's the idea that point scoring that we're used to in games, video games, is now bleeding into our everyday lives. And that by assigning points to things, you can get consumers to do, whether it's to get discounts on products or to behave in a certain way. And if we can, we can show the Epic Win video, which is essentially, it's an iPhone app, which is a to-do list that doubles as a slimline RPG. See if we can just watch that video quickly. Coming.
It's you.
And this is also something which has happened, again, not just in apps like this, but it's things like Foursquare. It uses GPS. So, you know, the idea that you can check into places and you earn badges and there's different points and prizes for different brands. Do we have the video? Okay. Well, if the video comes, we'll come. But guys, is this something which you're seeing a lot of now, this idea of gaming mechanics and kind of influencing people's behavior according to points and, you know, making them behave in a certain way?
Yeah.
Yes.
But what are the implications for brands and advertisers?
You know, I think that, I mean, I'll just talk from one angle of it, right? And it's only because it's top of mind because we have a lot of retail clients. But, you know, like for what we're trying to do, and there was a Uniqlo thing that was recently similar to this, where the more you participated, right, the less the price got.
Yeah.
Uniqlo, and so Lucky instead Council. Of points, yeah. We're talking about making a price go down lower and lower and lower and lower. And I think that's like it's an interesting paradigm for a lot of retail clients.
Yeah.
That's where it gets interesting to me too, is when you take that model and transpose it to actual financial reward, because I think there's only so many sort of point ecosystems that any one person can get involved with before
sure.
they kind of develop points ecosystem.
If they're on Foursquare and Xbox Live, yeah. and it all starts to rack up, which points actually mean something.
But I mean, the Uniqlo campaign's a good example. Groupon is another good example. Groupon's like a social initiative. Do they have it in America, Groupon?
Yeah.
It's huge.
It's awesome. Basically, you sign up for a newsletter, and every day there's a new service which they've negotiated with some sort of company that says, if 200 people do this, then you'll get this thing at X amount discount. And it's basically just like economy of scale. It's something that builds on the economy of scale. That, to me, is where it gets interesting, is when there's actual financial sort of reward on the other end of that.
But do you think there are some brands that are sort of claiming that you can actually influence people's behavior. So, for example, Aquafresh could give you 10 points, you know, if you brush your teeth every day. And that's the idea of kind of gentle paternalism. It's,
there's a primal thing in all of us that wants to win. And collect.
Yeah.
We did it as kids with sticker collections, or getting the stars, you know, on the thing. Like the more math answers you have. I mean, it's in all of it. It's the primal urge.
But do you think the brands, rather than just using it to sell people stuff, do you think they can actually influence their behavior for the better? Whether it's, you know, encouraging their kids to do their homework or brushing their teeth twice a day. Or
I don't think actually brands individually have the ability to do that, but I think in aggregate there is a possibility. I mean, you look at Foursquare as a gaming platform for where I put my body. But there isn't yet one for, you know, if there was a sensor in your toothbrush and if there was a sensor in your face scrubber and a sensor in your razor. And, you know, if you brush your teeth for there could be like the Nike Plus for your toothbrush. I mean, Nike Plus is a great example, too, where they've turned running into a competitive, nonlinear thing where a lot of people can compete asynchronously. So I think it's a matter of time before manufacturers in aggregate begin to build in means for this, you know, game-like structure. I think it's inevitable. I think it's happening. I think it's really the marketers and manufacturers and retailers to put the infrastructure in place to make it possible, and for all of us to make it interesting. I think is really where we're going. I mean, it's happening. It's just, you know, when.
Yeah, and I mean, and that's also a game mechanic that's existed like even before the internet. I mean, look at the Marlboro Man, right? Like. Collecting all the, you know, the wrap. I don't know what you collected, but somehow you could get a hat or something, backpack thing, you know,
pugs.
There's like camel points.
It's your loyalty program, right? So even before digital or the internet, brands have been exploring this game mechanic for a while. But I think that now that we have something like the internet and mobile, right, it's maybe the most appropriate medium for it. And I think it's going to take it into exciting places.
And also the Internet of Things that we spoke about all different products becoming media channels and being connected, that's all going to facilitate it.
Yeah.
Okay. Awesome. Thanks, guys. Okay, can we see any questions on the screen, any audience-submitted questions? We've got about 5 or 10 minutes left, if anyone submitted a question via email. Okay. So we've got here, the first one. For MPOs, budget is always a difficult topic. Therefore, creativity is crucial. What's your view on engaging people for charities creatively? Get that?
Nonprofit organizations.
Nonprofit organizations.
Yeah, I actually am part, I'm the president of a nonprofit organization. And one of the things that we've done in engaging creative communities is to really have a solid brief for the people you work with. So the problem is defined very, very clearly. And then secondly, my most favorite thing is that if you're doing a negotiation with a creative person, that you you give away your opportunity to vote on that creative product. So we do all of our free work on commission. I mean, on basically as a commission. So Jeff would do the work, but he would do it exactly as he wants, and I wouldn't vote on. Right. I wouldn't be able to change the work in any way. Right. So it allows Jeff a platform for unadulterated creativity. So you could get the best of Jeff's creative at no price because he's doing the work he wants to do. That's what I found in terms of not having a budget. But if you do have any budget, giving that budget strictly as production money to actually allow that creative person to exercise their ability, I think is really the best way to handle that situation. Because nonprofit status is really, it's a tax structure, it's not a, it doesn't necessarily mean you're not a company and that you don't have cash flow. It just usually means that your vision is idealistic and for the common good. And I think everyone that's creative wants to help the common good. If you give them a platform and a little bit of money to do something really, really creative that they can stand behind and step out of the way, I think that's the best way to do it.
And I suppose in a way, being a nonprofit organization or a charity is your USP, and that people are less likely to kind of tune out because they're not thinking immediately that you're going to sell them something.
Yeah.
It's I might spend an extra 5 or 10 seconds engaging with this, whether it you know involves me clicking like, because I know actually it's for the better. It's for a good cause, right?
Yeah.
And also I think it forces people in some ways to be more creative because you cannot throw money at the problem. So you need to come up with a really nice kernel of an idea that's going to work, that makes sense for whatever the NPO is, but isn't necessarily going to cost a ton of money. And sometimes those are the ideas in a weird way that translate the most.
The other angle, too, is finding someone who is creative, that is passionate about your cause. They're more likely to want to give extra time. So I think filtering who you decide to bring closer to your organization is also important. And you can do that on Facebook. And you know, there's tools out there to find people who are creatively aligned with your mission. And then by selecting them and giving them the opportunity to share their voice with your group, I think is really
cool. Awesome. Do we have the next question? Okay. What is the difference between success for a creative and a client, and how do you marry the two?
That should be you.
Selfish creatives.
I mean, I think that, you know, at least I probably have a unique situation because, you know, the clients that we have led us into their organizations in a way that I think a lot of agencies, at least previously, haven't. And I think this is happening for a lot of places now, where the role of an advertising agency and as a creative is less about, it is about this, but it's not just about making ads for them. Like, when I think about, like, you know, who are my partners in making this ad or making this product solution, it's not just the people at the agency, it's also that client. I mean, a lot of our clients have come up with some really great ideas. Mm. They've been the ones who pushed us and made something really great. So I think, you know, the relationship that we have, it's a little bit less than we're on, you know, the client wants this, we want this. We're usually on the same page. And, you know, look, no great idea, truly great idea, got worse because, you know, you made a logo bigger. So, I mean, for us at least, we've got some great partnerships, and they're the ones who push us usually.
Do you find that, Mark, when you say you work on some briefs that are extremely open and some that are very, very tight, and is there ever that kind of conflict between what the client wants and what ultimately you want to do in a creative sense?
Weirdly enough, on the briefs that are very open is the ones where we're trying to, like, where we start with the kind of creative's needs at hand, and it's because usually when we get a creative brief, we're responding to the creative idea. But when a brief is open, we go back to the client and say, okay, what do you need to come out of this? Can you give us a strategic brief? So it kind of works in the inverse way. I don't think the two are necessarily mutually exclusive. I think there is obviously a tension in the middle sometimes about whether the creative that you're pursuing is ideal for the brand. And I don't necessarily think there's always a right answer to that question. It's almost a case-dependent sort of question that you have to ask.
Yeah. Really.
I mean, I think back to the Philips stuff that we did, for example, and that There's two ways to look at that. I think it won an Effie last night, so apparently it was effective as a piece of advertising, which is good.
Congratulations.
But there was a long period of time where we didn't know, because it was Philips Carousel was one of the first pieces we did, and it was selling a 5,000 euro TV.
Yeah.
And we thought to ourselves, like, what happens if they don't sell any of these TVs? Like, does this mean this campaign was a failure? And apparently they did, so that's a good thing. But even if it wasn't, it was a success for the brand in more intangible ways. It helped them realign themselves in a really sort of dramatic way and helped them sort of reposition themselves completely and totally as a completely different kind of company.
So in that sense, it's a sort of longer-term play, because even though they don't necessarily sell any more of their cinema ratio TV, it's just saying, this is the kind of the brand we're doing.
Absolutely.
This is our commitment to cinema. You know,
and that's something that they built on quite a lot now. It's like they have this makeover now as a brand, and all of the jobs that they commission are now sort of in that vein, which I think has been really, really sort of reinvigorating for them. But, you know, I think there's always going to be that friction in the middle about whether this is right for the creative or whether this is right for the brand. And the truth is, there's so many intangible things about stuff that's good for the creative that's also good for the brand.
Honestly, you'd worry if it was too easy anyway, wouldn't you?
Can I just interrupt for a second?
Sure, please do.
Now, you see there's one chair available here. I don't know if you've realized, but the guy's standing actually in the back for the whole time now, and he's waiting to do his speech.
Yeah, we are pretty much...
Can we bring
We are ready for him right now.
Yeah, which is perfect.
Thank you.
So Gary from Kite, give him a hand, please. We've a bit forgotten about him, but he's going to give you a speech now.
Thanks.
I thought there were four. Okay.
So maybe you continue for 2 seconds.
Sure. Do we have any more audience submitted questions just while Gary's getting set up?
Yeah.
We might have maybe one or two more. Okay, something I've been quite interested in, I think, is that a lot of what have we seen here, such as building campaigns outside of paid-for media, this idea of mass and niche, cultivating something in a niche space for only 5% of your budget, they feel almost like slightly kind of post-recessionary trends, as in that, you know, brands being less willing to kind of spend lots of money on doing kind of things that are really innovative and wacky and crazy. Now we've kind of finally clambered out of the recession. Have you guys found that the brands are being sort of more willing to sort of give over bigger portions of their budget to innovation and play and this sort of thing? Or is there still that sort of recessionary kind of mindset where they're slightly scared?
I mean, for me, like, something that I observed was when there was less money, right? The economic times, I thought it gave way to greater inventions, right? Because you have less money, you're forced to think even more creatively when you're... I mean, there's this thing about Shakespeare, right? Because he says, because of the iambic pentameter, that's what made him so creative. Like, they say if he didn't have that, his storytelling might not have been as good. And in much the same way, less money has bred, you know, more interesting, innovative things. Now, that stuff happening, now that you get more money, now the clients want to do it even more. So it's almost like the economy has let us sort of reset and think a little bit more about the type of work that we were doing. And now that there's sort of economy is getting a little bit better, clients are freeing up more cash, now they want to invest in more in the success that they got from the invention.
That's exciting, right? Because you've kind of like press reset. It's all about niche and innovation, but then it's kind of, you know.
He's ready.
Okay.
It was kind of getting scary a little bit. So I'm Gary, I'm with Kite. Thanks for having me here. And the first question is, how do I fit into this creative panel with all these extremely creative people from these leading agencies? And as Mark opened his speech, I also bring a little bit of different perspective on this whole matter by introducing Kite and some cases that great agencies did based on our technology. So we heard a lot of these words across this panel, so I heard a lot of Facebook and a lot of iPhone and iPad and probably Flash, IPTV, boxy stuff. So all these buzzwords around the technology that lays beyond this creative things that that these guys are doing. And that's basically where we come from with Kite. So we are a white labeled video platform, a startup from San Francisco, and what we developed is a 360-degree social video platform. And just briefly what it is, we believe that with the audiences more and more going online, what they do is they don't go only online by the computer. They use a whole variety of different devices to go online. So therefore, we need to bring experiences into these different touch points. One is online, another one is the whole mobile world and connected devices, where you need to have an experience, and the third is the whole social web, Facebook, MySpace, Twitter, and so on. And therefore, we developed this 360-degree social video platform. And I have one complex slide I'm showing here, just to give you a little bit of an idea of what you can do with the platform, and then I show a couple of examples what creative agencies did with our platform. Looking at all these boxes looks complicated, but what you have there is, on top you have production tools that we provide in the platform. On the left side you have online production tools, on the right side mobile production tools, and on the lower side you have the distribution for online and also for mobile. So what the platform can do is, you can produce, for example, in the upper left side, from a website, so you can do user-generated activities and tell them upload videos and bring that into an idea. You can have people upload videos by email. You have on the top right side a whole variety of mobile producers where you can distribute mobile apps that use people to upload videos. And on the downside, we distribute into online the social web, connected devices like Boxy, Roku, WatchMe is very common in the German market. And on the mobile side, mobile web, a whole variety of mobile apps that we develop or individual mobile experiences. So a couple of things that agencies did with our technology. One example is from an agency in Hamburg, it's Deep Blue, who developed Swatch TV. And just showing that very briefly, what they did is, it's basically around three channels. It's a very customized media player experience with social sharing and the approach to have the whole 360-degree rollout in the future. Showing you a little bit how that can look. So basically, that's the experience that you have on the website. It's a very attractive video experience. You have search functionality on it. So you can search through the whole video that is provided there. You have a very attractive way to see the video. You can like it, you can share it, you have Twitter connection inside of it, so it's completely socially integrated. And you can also share it on Facebook, MySpace, so drive the video experience across the web. So that's just one example. Another example is Hope for Haiti. I think probably most of you have seen that or have experienced what happened there. And MTV did a very special activity around that. They did a beneficial concert, and what they needed is they needed a mobile experience that needed to be delivered extremely fast. So it needed to be a custom iPhone app with live streaming to the iPhone to drive donations, and all of this in 48 hours turnaround until it is downloadable in the App Store. So that's really a very challenging request that they had there. And as we have a technology for that, we were able to deliver that, so have a completely mobile experience on the phone where they could deliver that Hope for Haiti in a very short time frame. And it was extremely successful by over 100,000 apps downloaded in 24 hours, and it totally has driven over 61 million revenues or money raised for the Haiti relief. And that is basically possible based on the mobile app framework that we have, where we have a turnkey solution that makes it extremely easy to deliver a mobile experience based on video in a extremely short time frame. And another thing, as we have talked so much about Facebook, we believe that it is very important also to have not only the standard Facebook player functionality for video, but deliver a full video experience inside of Facebook. And one example that was done with Calvin Klein by Deep Focus, that is, the requirement was to have HD live streaming within Facebook, and not only Facebook, but also on the calvinklein.com homepage, and a real-time chat beside that, and on-demand behind-the-scenes content also connected to it. And that's how that looked like. And we also have a turnkey solution for that to deliver an experience like this. So you have live streaming from the New York Fashion Show directly in Facebook. And that's a really attractive experience that you can deliver there. And the last one that I would like to show you is a campaign that was a Super Bowl campaign this year for the customer HomeAway, done by Publicis. The special thing around this is that, as it was a Super Bowl campaign, there was a lot of requirement on performance for this campaign. So, very technically, we had to be able to scale up to 3,000 hits per second, whatever that means. And it should be a fully custom user experience that is there. There should be pro episode and also user-generated content. And it needed to have engagement and social sharing. And that's what we did is, it's a very interesting idea that they came up. They kind of reinvented the how are they called? The Griswolds on Vacation. Probably some of you know these guys. It was movies in the 80s where the Griswolds with Jesse Chase were going on vacation. So the whole idea is to reinvent these guys and have the whole family back again, letting them go on vacation where they have to stop in a hotel and they have a very bad experience in the hotel, and then they finally end up in their holiday house where they have a very attractive experience. And it was driven by a 30-second Super Bowl spot that was directly leading to the website where you could watch about half an hour of Griswolds on Vacation, and then you could upload your own hotel experience and be part of a sweepstake where you could win a travel worth $10,000. So very interactive. And the interesting thing is that, I think in the first couple of minutes, there were over 1.5 million video views in that. One third was driven from viral embeds, and they had a 500% increase in uniques, and the second time all-time traffic. So it was extremely successful for them. And that's just some example that I wanted to show you. Basically what we do as Kite is, we have developed a technology that probably makes some things easier for creative guys like you to bring new ideas to life and probably even make ideas possible that hadn't been possible before. So thank you for your time.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, we're pretty much at our time limit now. So. All that's really left for me to do is to thank our speakers. I think we've seen some absolutely fascinating case studies and some trends and some points that have been raised. The ones that have really stood out for me today, firstly, make innovation a priority, okay? Even if this means failing, because you know, for every 9 failures, you're going to get 1 success, and that's going to be a real hit. And as part of this, you know, be sure to make time for play. Okay, you might think you might not have time for play anymore, because like I said at the beginning, people, you know, they're going across all these different platforms, and it's a quick fix culture, okay? And it's difficult because they can't tune out. But, you know, the stuff that's really going to stop them in their tracks, the stuff that's really engaging, is the playful stuff, which is why it's so, so important. Also realize that sometimes 2, 3, 4, however many heads are better than one. Doug knows probably better than most people that, you know, it's this marrying of the right creative with the right production guys, with the right tech guys, that really breeds the truly game-changing work. And also this fascinating recombinance culture that Mark talked about. And ultimately, the internet as we know it is dying, really. The web is not, however, and that's the most important thing. But as we, as consumers, as people, as users, are unshackled and we're let out into this kind of real but ultimately connected world, it's the brands that are willing to entertain us, to challenge us, and to facilitate us in this environment, which are really, really going to cut through. Before we came on, I think someone said we were talking generally about the traditional advertising model, and someone said, advertising sucks, doesn't it? And I think everyone kind of agreed, and I agree, to be honest. But the exciting thing for me is that what we've talked about today isn't advertising. Okay, I couldn't tell you exactly what it is, but I know we're going to have an awful lot of fun finding out together. So with that in mind, I'd just like you to join me now in thanking all our speakers and panelists, Doug Jaeger, Jeff Benjamin, Mark Pitlick, and Gary Pipple. Thank you very much.